This program was produced by the Chemical Heritage Foundation. Our mission is to collect, preserve, and make known the history of chemistry, chemical engineering, and related sciences and technologies.
Welcome to Distillations, a history show that takes a sideways look at science and technology. I'm Michal Meyer, a historian of science and editor of Chemical Heritage magazine here at CHF.
And I'm Bob Kenworthy. I'm a chemist, and I'm also here at CHF. Now, you may have noticed that we've changed the name of this show, but we're still dedicated to telling great stories about science and culture. And today's program, Alchemy's Rainbow: Pigment Science and the Art of Conservation. Our guests today are Mark Bockrath and Elisabeth Berry Drago. Mark is a paintings conservator who has worked on some of the CHF paintings, and Lisa studies 17th century Dutch paintings and the connection between art and science. Welcome.
And I just want to add that Lisa is also a fellow here at CHF, so another connection to our organization. Before we dig into the science and the art, we have a short video that follows Lisa as she gathers the supplies a 17th century painter would have needed before they could start painting their masterpiece. So let's watch that now.
Painting in 2014 starts at the art supply store. You can get paint in a tube, brushes, prepare canvases, and you'll be ready to go. Telesigning blue. Once upon a time, paint didn't come in tubes. It came in the form of dried pigments that were ground up and mixed with oil to produce paint. Now that we've got our pigments, it's time to mix our paint. What we'll need is a muller, that's a tool for grinding paint, and a slab, a surface to grind paint on. We want something nice and hard, like a granite, so you can get the nice tooth to it, grind the paints up very fine. So we're going to check out all these tile shops and see if they've got a good slab for us. Here we go. So a granite slab like this is a little bit too smooth. You want some tooth to be able to grab those hold of those pigment particles. So what I do is take something like this and grind it down with a fine carborundum powder, get a little texture to the surface so that it can really grind effectively. But here's granite, so this is your stuff. So as you can see, we had some great success. We got a granite slab we can use to grind pigments on. We're standing in front of a butcher shop because in the 17th century, painters didn't have tubes or cans or Tupperware to keep their paint inside. Basically, the only way you could keep your prepared paint fresh was inside of a pig's bladder. Howdy.
Hi.
That looks awesome. I was wondering if you have any pig's bladders or any bladders of any kind.
No.
No bladders.
No.
So like a bladder is not a common thing that you would have or
at one time we could get them. You can't get them anymore. Any animal part has to be inspected.
Gotcha.
Even if it's not going to be used for food.
Gotcha.
And nobody wants to be
inspecting pig bladders.
Yeah.
Okay. That's great. Well, thank you so much anyway. I know you can't. We'll pretend. Yeah. Thank you so much.
All right. Sorry.
Well, we didn't get it. So I guess the contemporary solution would be Tupperware. So we've got our slab, and now we've got our hand-blown glass muller. Back in the day, they probably would have used granite. We've got a palette knife for getting us started. We've got our dry pigments, in this case, burnt sienna. And we've got our linseed oil. So now we're all set to get started.
And Lisa, I see you have brought the supplies with you. Still no pig's bladder.
Still no pig's bladder. Unfortunately, we just weren't able to get one.
Though I'm amazed. The butcherman said that in the past he used to carry a pig's bladder. I mean, if you're not painting, what would you use a pig's bladder for?
Well, actually, the example that he gave us was that he had gotten pig's bladders before for a group that was doing reenactments of medieval reenactments and medieval music. So pig's bladders were used as instruments. Basically, they're watertight, airtight. They can be inflated. So they're sort of the early modern kickball, but they also make great percussion instruments and things like that. So yeah, at one time he was able to get a hold of them.
Well, I'm sure we'll return to the pig's bladder later and how artists actually use them. But in the meantime, Bob, I have a question for you.
Okay.
I have heard a rumor that you may have a connection to art, or at least to paint. So tell me, is there an artist hidden underneath that steely scientific exterior of yours?
Not likely. Yes, I spent 20 years of my life in the paint business, so primarily with automotive and automotive repair paint, which is quite different from what we're talking about today. And I'd like to point out to anybody who's a paint technologist that might be listening to us, we're going to be talking about pigments, and you will notice that we will use the word pigment incorrectly many times because we're really referring to paint when we say pigment. And we do know the difference between paint and pigment here. We do know that the artist would have to grind the pigment into some film former in order to put it on the canvas and make a piece of art out of it. Now that film former might just be egg whites, right, or such, but nonetheless, we'll talk about pigments when we probably ought to say paints.
And we will do our best to use the correct terminology.
Yeah, we will try to make sure to use the pigment for pigment and paint for paint.
though frankly, I think it makes more sense to just deal with it the way an artist would deal with nomenclature, because that's primarily what we're going to be talking about. And I'd like to remind our viewers that they can ask questions by using Twitter, using hashtag SciCulture. Or you can send a question via Tumblr on chemheritage.tumblr.com. And if your question is read out during the show, we're going to send you a 17th century alchemy painting.
No, we're not.
No, actually, we're really not. We're going to send you a poster of a 17th century alchemical painting.
So. We would like to, but we don't have enough alchemical paintings to hand out to people. Well, getting back to pigments and paints, after having seen your video, I now know better that paints don't have to come in tubes. But I'd always thought that throughout history that you went to the art store, you got your paint in tubes, and I would imagine Leonardo da Vinci going down to his local paint store, asking for the tubes of paint that he wanted, and then going off to paint the Mona Lisa. I know I'm wrong, but give me some history of pigments. When do they first start? How were they first used? And what were they?
Well, first of all, the use of tube paints is really a mid-19th century invention. So before that, they were put up in pig's bladders. But the easiest way to get pigments was just whatever occurred naturally in your area. So going back as far as cave paintings, thousands of years BC, there were many pigments that were easily available, soot for black and reds and yellows and whites from some earth pigments. And those were the ones that were used in the cave paintings. So as early as that time, there were pigments that were readily available, and then shortly after that, thousands of years ago, they started to manufacture pigments on a larger scale and refine different types of ores to get brighter colors, and actually fairly early on, some colors were made in sort of a pseudo-chemistry lab of long ago.
Thank you. I had no idea there was such even a prehistory to art in that sense.
So what does an artist look for in a pigment?
Well, certainly there are qualities. I mean, a pigment is what provides color. So you're looking for something that's extremely vivid and beautiful. You want a brilliant color, something that is going to cover your surface well, because pigments obviously have properties of coverage, since it's a what's at the most basic level, a pigment is a particle that's insoluble, so basically sits, is suspended within the medium. So you want something that has good coverage, and also that's going to interact well with your binding materials and with your other pigments. So something that's not particularly reactive, something that's long-lasting. And there's also certain qualities of handling that are very desirable. So something like Van Dyke Brown, which is also known as Kessel Earth or Cologne Earth, it's one of those earth colors that you mentioned that sort of derive from just from soil, from clays and things like that. It's an iron oxide pigment. But it's very beautiful, it becomes very translucent in oil. So it has a wonderful translucent glowing quality that really lends itself well to the kind of work that's being done in the 17th century. Okay. So highly prized.
So what other kind of pigments perhaps would have been used in the 17th century?
Well,
As early as the 17th century, you would find verdigris, although that's, I think, a pigment that's even earlier, but it was used quite a bit. You see smalt, which is a cobalt and tin containing glass. It's like a ground-up glass frit, sort of a dull blue. That was used quite a bit. It had problems later on. People noticed that it became sort of a mottled gray color, so it fell out of use. But those pigments, and then of course all the earth pigments that were used going back thousands of years were still in use then and still are now, many of them.
So these are the kind of pigments that you would literally dig out of the ground, out of dirt?
The ochres and umbers and siennas, yeah, mm-hmm. and others too.
And you mentioned Van Dyke Brown, got that name because of the artist using
the
it.
The artist Anthony Van Dyke, yeah.
And are there other pigments that are named for artists who...
Not that I'm aware of. There are certain names like there's Indian yellow, which supposedly came from which was a later pigment that was supposedly created from the urine of cows who are only eating mango leaves and yes. things like this. There's Egyptian blue, which is a very vibrant, beautiful blue, which is almost exclusively used in antiquity. There's all kinds of wacky.
Yeah, and there are some pigments like Scheele's green, which is named after the, or Vauquelin's green, which are named mm-hmm. after the chemist who developed them.
Okay.
So you mm-hmm. see.
I have heard of a pigment called mummy brown. My understanding is it's not used anymore. Can you?
Well, there's a pigment called bitumen or asphaltum, which is a tarry-like pigment which doesn't dry properly. But it's a beautiful, rich brown, and a lot of artists have used it through time. But it was also the material that was used for mummification, and it's a dark brown, which is why when the mummy loses the wrapping on his finger, you can see that it's a dark brown finger. But in the late 19th century, when people were robbing graves in Egypt, and there was a lot of knowledge of locations of mummies, some of the lesser mummies, not King Tut, but some of the lesser mummies' graves were robbed, and they were ground up and mixed with oil into a pigment called mummy, which is similar to asphaltum and bitumen, but it's just that it's been used on a human. But it was a short-lived fad, but there is some use of that late 19th century.
Yeah, I'm sorry we can't tell you that it's just a nickname. I wish it was just a nickname, but it's not.
It really, really did contain human.
Yeah, yeah, made with real human.
Made with
and it was just human. Because it was a concentrated source of asphaltum.
Okay.
And it was specifically the colors that these pigments could provide that is what interested different painters. Mm-hmm. So did different painters have preferences as to what kind of pigments they would use? I mean, were some just simply better than others? Or perhaps more rarer and so more precious in some way?
Well, sure. There's the color quality. There's the preciousness or worth. And as you were mentioning about color, one of the reasons that color is so such a determining factor is that in the origin of pigments comes from beautiful colors found in nature, basically. Mm-hmm. So the idea of capturing those somehow. For example, I brought with me this is synthetic ultramarine, but real ultramarine was made from lapis lazuli. Basically, it's a precious stone dug out of the ground, powdered, ground and powdered, and produces an extremely beautiful blue, which was highly prized, highly expensive. And so it's one of the few pigments that shows up in artist contracts of the 14th, 15th, 16th centuries. Most most people who are commissioning art do not necessarily make the determinations about pigments. Pigments are made, it's the artist's discretion, really, to use what pigments they're selecting. They're going and buying, they're refining in the workshop, they're grinding. Ultramarine is one of the few exceptions because it is so precious, so expensive, that we'd usually be part of the contracting process is saying, well, if I'm going to pay this much for an altarpiece, there'd better be ultramarine on it.
Right.
So, but other things are, it's really the artist's choice, what they prefer to work with, what their palette is like. There's color theory as far as the suitability of using certain colors. There's symbolism in colors. All those factors go into the choice.
And it would vary by artistic style and period. So if you have, also with what's available in the 19th century, you see some brighter pigments that were invented that were used in preference to duller palettes in earlier centuries. But if an artist like Rembrandt, it uses mostly earth pigments because it's a brownish, yellowish palette. But even in the same century, you might find someone who uses bright blues and mixes reds with white to get a bright pink because that's their style of their painting. You see French 17th century painters might be a brighter palette than a contemporary by Rembrandt. But then even within France, you'd find a duller palette in certain landscape painters. And it's really a preference. It's what's available. It's also the preference of the artist and what palette he or she prefers. Mm-hmm.
So now let me take you off on a chemistry tangent, if I may. The brilliant colors, bright colors, I think of salts of arsenic, salts of mercury, antimony, right? They have more than just color properties, don't they?
Yeah.
They're a little toxic, right?
Is this the dark side of art?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Arsenic is a major component in several pigments that last. So, for example, there's an arsenic pigment called orpiment. And orpiment is known in antiquity. It's known by the Egyptians. They make use of orpiment. And it's basically mined arsenic. It creates a very beautiful yellowish, goldish color. Mm-hmm. There's a late 14th, early 15th century writer, Cennino Cennini, who is a sculptor, an artist, and he writes a treatise, basically a handbook of all the stages in making art, sculpting, painting, all these things. He specifically has a chapter on grinding colors, and he warns, don't put orpiment in your mouth. or basically, don't get so caught up in grinding orpiment that you accidentally touch your fingers to your mouth because, you'll suffer the consequences.
You'll get arsenic poisoning.
Right.
Well, for years, arsenic was used as a disinfectant for animal hairs, and so it was put along with glue on the point of watercolor brushes, and artists often would tip the brush by putting it in their mouth, and so, arsenic, now they don't use it anymore, but for a long time they did.
There's actually, emerald green was a color, a synthetic color that came in much, much later than the period that I work on. Mm-hmm. But emerald green was a very very brilliant, very beautiful, and very cheap green, and one of the most vibrant greens that they had produced so far, because up to this point you have sort of a thinner, more watery, brownish, greenish, and emerald green is just stunning and super vivid. And they love to use it in textiles, they love to use it in wallpaper, they use it in printing, they use it in everything. And there's actually, there's a rumor, fable, urban legend. Right. Napoleon was poisoned, they think, maybe. They dug him up and found arsenic in his hair. And there's a thought that it might be connected to the emerald green wallpaper of where he was kept. And certainly there's a lot of the sort of fumes, the arsenic fumes coming from things, that expose, that long-term exposure.
Particularly on the island of Elba, the high humidity.
Right. Could have done a lot of damage.
Okay. And that particular color of green was very popular in France in that era, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So were artists aware of the dangers they faced and the materials they worked with?
I think pretty early on, they weren't as aware as they are now, but I think people even early on knew that lead in particular was a problem. It could make you very ill. I don't know that they understood that some of these metals built up in your system over time, and rather than just getting acutely sick from ingesting lead, that it actually built up over time and that that was a problem. And it seems like people didn't get how bad arsenic was until 19th century or so. It was used, again, as a disinfectant. I know some conservator who works in a collection that has a lot of taxidermy specimens, and it was used to keep bugs off the feathers and taxidermy mm-hmm. specimens and hair. And to this day, you have to wear gloves or not go in at all to handle those collections because there's so much arsenic.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, I've heard of the Mad Hatter. I think that's a fairly common...
Yeah, which is mercury.
Cows. Yeah.
Mercury.
Yeah, was mercury used... I mean, because mercury is fairly toxic fairly quickly.
I think it was used to disinfect the beaver fur before they made the hat out of it. And that's why he was quite mad.
Right.
And to block it so it would hold its shape as well.
Yeah. So at least Lewis Carroll knew that it was toxic.
Right.
Well, mercury shows up in a lot of things. It shows up in vermilion. Vermilion is one of those synthesized pigments that shows up in the late Middle Ages, it's actually a pigment known from antiquity, which mm-hmm. is written about again in the Middle Ages. So that's a sort of Greco-Roman 1,000-year-old pigment synthesized alchemically from mercury and sulfur, a union of mercury and sulfur. But mercury is used for all kinds of things. Gilding.
Well, we were discussing in preparation for this how probably the worst art-related job that we could think of was 17th to 18th century ormolu gilding, especially done in France, where on your wooden cabinet you would have bronze mounts that were gilded. And the way that was done is a mercury amalgam was brushed onto the bronze, and then gold leaf was placed on top of that, and the entire item was heated, which drove the mercury off, presumably toward you, and then the gilding was then permanently onto the bronze. Mm-hmm. But that's, you know, there was a very short lifespan for people who did ormolu gilding.
Wow. For the workers.
Well, we're going to move on to a slightly more cheerful subject now. It's time for some high-tech wizardry, so we're going into very much the present and looking at how you can use high-tech equipment to study old paintings. So in this case, it's what's called an XRF scanner, and which was used to uncover some of the chemical secrets of one of the paintings here.
There's never been XRF scanning done on this particular set of pictures. We did UV analysis of the pictures first and then proceeded to the XRF. If you are looking at the painting, the surface of the painting under ultraviolet light, it'll become very quickly apparent what sections are original, or at least what sections are all the same, you know, have like a fluorescent continuity, let's say. Like, we sort of went into this hoping to find alchemical pigments or, you know, vermilion or verdigris or some of those sort of interestingly produced, you know, like that have these interesting processes to them. Basically, it's turned on, the beam goes out, it sort of registers what's coming back, and then it's turned off. It will start to register spikes of elements there. On this small alchemist that they're looking at now, we absolutely did. We found mercury, we found mercuric sulfide in that red jar lid, which strongly indicates that this is vermilion.
And I'd like to remind you to remember to send your questions in by Twitter, hashtag SciCulture, or by Tumblr, chemheritage.tumblr.com. And while I remind you as a viewer to do that, we actually have a question coming in on Twitter. McCall?
We have a question from Clara Stories. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that right. The question is, how affordable were pigments in early modern times? What was easily obtainable or expensive and difficult to find?
Sure. I think generally speaking, pigments were part of the painter's toolkit. I mean, so they're an expense that's built into the cost of making a painting. So looking at early modern inventories and contracts and things like that, there is a consciousness on the part of artists as to time, to equipment, to labor and any kind of their apprentices and things like that, those are factored into the cost. So basically, when someone commissions a painting, there's an understanding that, that pigments are going to be purchased on behalf of this particular painting, most likely. So that said, something like ultramarine is obviously going to be your most precious, top of the scale. There's a pretty steep drop, and you get to things like vermilion, the synthetic pigments, and then earth colors, lead white, and the earth colors and lead white are totally ubiquitous. They're factored totally into the cost of doing business. So you know, you don't have to imagine that painters are bankrupting themselves trying to cover everything in ultramarine or anything.
And then ultramarine, I think when around 1802, when the natural form is replaced by the invention of artificial ultramarine, it goes from being the most expensive pigment to one of the cheaper pigments almost overnight. So, but again, I think that to some degree, the more processing that has to be done to either an ore or in alchemical or chemical situation to produce a pigment, the more expensive it would be. Or just by rarity, something like a natural ultramarine, which is largely from Afghanistan. And then that would be the top end, like Lisa said, and I think when you get down to soot or colored muds, those very cheap, as they are now.
Mm-hmm. We have alchemy in the title of this show. So I'd like to push on, what is the connection between alchemy and pigments? Lisa, you want to pick that one up to start with?
I would love to. simply put, pigments are, a number of pigments are created by alchemy. And this is something that's understood and something that's discussed in the literature of the period. Our friend Cennino Cennini talks about alchemy when he provides an entry for almost all his pigments that says, this is what it is, this is how it's made, this is how you grind it, this is what you add it to, this is what you absolutely don't add it to. You know, in certain sections, he'll identify, for vermilion, for example, he'll say it's a color, you know, produced by alchemy using a retort. So he even makes a specific reference to a retort, which is basically an alchemical vessel, which you would use to make all number of things. Mm-hmm. You would distill substances in it. Mm-hmm. So alchemically created pigments, verdigris, the various other copper-containing pigments are made through combining basically, you know, the copper with the acetic acid in processes that are very alchemical, very much connected to all these strands of early chemistry, using the same equipment produced in laboratories, you know, making chemical medicines and things like that, very, very, very similar.
So your local alchemist would be your art supply store?
In a sense, yeah. I mean, apothecaries are carrying you know, chemical medicine, purgatives, and speaking of arsenic, it's certainly something that will clear you out. in a small dose, it might not kill you, it'll make you feel like you're dying, but you know, so apothecaries, druggists, things like that are often selling pigments and medicine side by side. In the 17th century, you get a greater specialization, so you get color men emerging. Specialist art dealer.
By the 17th, 18th century, you start to see more actual colormen who you can walk in their store and buy canvas, you can buy ground material, you can buy pigments, you can buy the oil. And then by the 19th century, that's pretty well established, that the art store is established by then.
Yeah. So I'm still fascinated by the idea of, you know, what we might think of as a pharmacy, you could also go and get paint supplies and there would be the same ingredients in both.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and only a lack of knowledge of how they would kill you would give that affinity, you know, because it's people didn't know that this pigment, this substance, which probably would be properly used as a pigment, shouldn't have been used as medicine, but they were interchangeable to some of them.
So it's amazing anyone survived the 17th century. If it wasn't the paints, it would be the medicines that would kill you.
Yeah. Yes. Well, and in certain places, they're taxed in the same way. There are apothecaries guilds in London and England in the middle of the 17th century who are taxing pigments and drugs under the same category. So it's you know, it's from where they come from, not necessarily their documented use. It's really the sources of things that are important to people.
So Lisa, walk us through the process. If you're an artist. What would you do if you're collecting your pigments, and what are you going to mix, and what are you not going to mix, and how does that all work?
And how, I mean, to go back even further a little bit, if you go to the apothecary or the alchemist, what are you going to ask for, and are you actually going to see the alchemist make it for you?
Probably not. That's probably happening someplace safe, where, you know, if there's an explosion, the entire town doesn't burn down to. But basically, there's various ways that you can get it. So mostly you're going to get stuff that is, not to the level of this kind of fineness. I mean, this is like paprika or flour or something. It's extremely fine. Mm-hmm. You're not going to get that. You're going to get something that looks a lot more like rock salt or, something with a chunky consistency that you've got to grind down yourself in your mm-hmm. workshop. There are certain things. There's always the problem of adulteration. Cennino Cennini says, if you're going to get vermilion, get it in a rock so that you can make sure they haven't, powdered it with red lead or brick dust or something. Mm-hmm. There's that problem. But basically, so you're going to bring home, you're going to go, you're going to pick out your pigment, you're going to bring home the sort of crystallized, rocky, chunky form of it, and you're going to grind it down. So certain pigments you would start to crush dry and then grind wet with linseed oil or with water. There's a recipe for grinding certain colors with urine, which they don't advise don't advise you to do because it can spoil really easily. That's the reason that it can spoil.
So it's not almost as though you're talking about a recipe book here as much as anything else.
Yeah, nice. It's very much like that. And I would say that persists for a long time.
Yeah, and a lot of what conservators have found over the years about pigments and pigment use and paint manufacture is from recipe books like that. And then by the 17th, 18th century, there's a fair amount of books which are how-to paint books for artists that have recipes like that and which pigments you should use for flesh tones and that sort of thing. It's a good source for us.
So it's really instructions to painters in a mm-hmm. way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm. absolutely.
Yeah, there's the more theoretical side of these texts, the artist should be clean and virtuous, right. And good living, the good living
right,
guy.
Right, especially Cennino.
But then there's also a tradition of very technical handbooks that are basically here's the quick and dirty. This is what you need to know about this pigment. These are the things it reacts with. This is how to grind it. This is how long to grind it. And hopefully you have 14-year-olds to do that for you because it's very hard.
So your apprentices would do all the hard work. But who would be reading these books? Would it be the painters we would have heard of today? Would it have been famous 17th century painters? Would it have been people like Rembrandt? Would they have gone to these kind of books for information?
I think it's kind of a mix because I think you can exaggerate in either direction and say mm-hmm. that artists had no technical, no literary training, no textual references, and they only learned via the workshop. Or you can say that they relied on these totally and they followed the directions to the letter, and I think the truth is probably somewhere in between those things.
Where you really see it a lot is in the late 19th, or actually throughout the 19th and in the early 20th century when some artists are interested in replicating earlier techniques, or they're interested in how Titian painted and they're experimenting, or they're interested in the tempera revival, they're trying to paint like earlier egg tempera painters. And I think when you see correspondence between one artist to another, one suggesting this is what you should use, and the other artist saying, no, I wouldn't dare use that, that's going to crack, you shouldn't be using that. And you can see artist by artist, some of them are really interested in experimentation, and they go back to the early text, even if they're misunderstanding them, and others who just feel, I have my linseed oil and my tube paint, and that's good enough for me. And it really just varies quite a lot.
But as a conservator, you have to know all that timeline and all that sequence of
right,
how any given artist would have constructed
the
painting.
We read a lot of those texts to see what we're getting into. When you can see a painting that's been done by an experimenter, it's good to read what they were experimenting with before mm-hmm. you touch the painting. So that's very helpful, having all that writing.
Yeah, great.
Well, so. I think it's now time to get into the hands-on aspect of this show. You have all your equipment.
Great. Mm-hmm.
Tell us what you're doing and how you're going to be making these pigments. And I see you have a Band-Aid on your hand. I hope you have
a Band-Aid. I do. No, it's unrelated bread knife incident. But so basically, we've been talking about pigments, so this is what we would start with, something. You can see the stars of the video, which were the slab, the granite slab, and the glass muller, which is a blown glass muller, which came from eBay, because despite the fact that most tubes do come in, most paints do come in tubes these days, there is still a community of artists who like the old materials and like to do sort of traditional things. And certainly an understanding of those, you know, historic works is, I think, accentuated by understanding what kind of materials they're working with. So palette knife, dried pigment, slab, and linseed oil. So essentially, I always have trouble opening this jar and I might need assistance. Yeah. Thank you. You should have pre-opened the jar. Look at that. That's beautiful. That's the touch of a true conservator and materials expert.
It's one of my jobs at home.
Opening jars.
So, opening jars.
Basically, you've
it's
got your
useful.
you're very useful. You've got your dry pigment, and you want to be working wet into dry. So a small amount of linseed oil goes into this pigment mixture, and basically you start by making paste. And depending on the thickness, depending on the viscosity of the oil that you're using, because painters sometimes thicken their oils by boiling them or, you know, adding any kind of any variety of oils and thickeners and thinners and drying agents and all kinds of stuff. So basically at that point, you're going to get started and start grinding. And it's just the motion of the muller. It's the surface tension and the surface grabbing the pigments and grinding them a little bit. So at a certain point, you'll be satisfied. You'll have your paint at the proper thickness. I'm going to do a little bit thinner than you might want for a nice
impasto. See how much darker the pigment gets when it's saturated with the oil, too.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's the sort of secret of varnishes and things like that, too. Like, it's not just protective. It's that if you've ever gotten a piece of cloth wet, you know, it becomes much darker almost instantly because of that saturation quality. So it brings out the richness of the pigments when you do that. So now you can see that our pigment is coming together with the linseed oil. And it's just a matter of scraping it up and getting it into a paste platter now. So
how long would you perhaps... if you were a 17th century painter, how long would you spend grinding your pigment?
Well, it depends on the pigment too. There are certain mineral pigments that something like malachite or something, if you grind it too much, you get a sort of muddied quality to it. And other things where you've really got to grind it very, very fine and powdery for it to, you know, work nicely in the oil.
And some pigments, they vary with how much oil they need to be made into paint. Something like white lead takes very little oil, and it really is hard to, it's so stiff, it's very hard to do. Whereas something like viridian takes a lot of oil, so it's very smooth, very slippery.
And of course, paint in a tube, the dispersion is all made mechanically, right?
Well, they grind them on wheels, there is a fair amount of hand work in the better varieties of paint tubes, where they mix it in a milling wheel and then put it into the tubes.
Okay.
The one advantage of what Lisa made is that it's pure pigment. There's no chalk. There's no adulterants. There's no cheaper pigments. There's no dyes in it. So it's just a really beautiful, rich color when you make it yourself.
Great.
So I have a I was going to say conversation question. That doesn't make sense. I have a conservation question for you via Twitter. This is from Kevin Brandon. How much was known about UV light dulling colors? And what was done to prevent it, if anything?
People, I think, started to understand it, especially in the 20th century. And I think they were able to quantify it in the later 20th century. But I think there was some sense that even if they didn't know what exactly the UV component, the ultraviolet component was, everyone has known for centuries that light fades things. And of course, watercolors and thinly applied paint like that, or textiles that were dyed, people knew that those were the things that faded first. People tried to varnish watercolors which just made them dark yellow in a few years. People tried to add varnish with the paint or varnish thickly over certain colors that they knew were going to fade in order to prevent fading. So I think people knew that light, whether what component it was or not, they didn't know. But I think people knew that things faded for centuries and centuries, and people do write quite a bit about that. In fact, one of my favorite artists, Joshua Reynolds, who used cochineal, if you look at one of his paintings, he had a tendency to use this carmine red in the flesh, which was a dye made into a pigment, and it made nice rosy cheeks. And he would use a yellow as well to make the flesh tones. And often the red color fades out. So many of his paintings from the 1750s and 60s, they look like dead figures or wax figures, because they have no blush of pink in their cheeks. And people knew that right away. And everyone criticized him at the time, saying that you had flying colors and that the colors would fade right away. And you could buy a Reynolds with this coloration, but it'll be something different 10 years later. So people were aware of it. And some artists avoided certain colors that they knew would fade.
But some pigments do last forever.
Right? Yeah, a lot of the earth colors, stay pretty much unchanged for a long, long time. I mean, it depends on what medium they're in. Sometimes the medium could discolor. You could have problems with that. But colored mud is just colored mud forever. So
yeah. It doesn't change. It doesn't come off. Yeah. Yes. One thing we have touched on a little bit, and I want to get more in depth, is how it seems as though pigments have moved from a craft to a science. I'm thinking, you know, we're talking about paint and tubes developing in the 19th century, and it seems as though things become more mass produced. Mm-hmm. Can you walk us through the history of painters grinding their own pigments and made from very different ingredients, but they knew exactly where it came from, and it was mostly natural sources and things like that, to where we are today in terms of the synthetic colors? What happened to turn, I guess, pigments from a craft into a science in a way? That was a long question.
Yeah.
Well, I would agree with that at some level, and on one level I would say that something like vermilion does represent a very scientific endeavor and you know, cutting edge science in the sense of alchemy and chemistry and controlling reactions and getting a better product out of it. Something like, for example, alchemists are engaged in looking for the philosopher's stone for chemical medicines and things like that. And vermilion actually has color stages that echo the color stages in the making of the philosopher's stone. So it is a highly scientific procedure, you know, at the time, for its time, it's a science, it's a technology definitely of its time. But I would totally agree that it moves, that pigment science moves into sort of the modern industrial chemical laboratory, certainly.
Well, there's a parallel with the history of chemistry, which I think really takes off in the late 18th century, early 19th century in Germany and France. And it's probably not coincidental that that's when there's a lot of new pigments from late 18th century all the way through mid 19th century, especially. And then the coal tar industry later on, the later 19th century, you start to see dyes being made into lake pigments. So I think the whole history of manufacturing, especially the coal tar industry, really promotes manufacture of pigments for more than just artists, but, you know, for house paint and everything else. And I think that the fact that it became possible to have art stores that were fully equipped with everything in the 19th century, and people stopped grinding their own paint in this work intensive way and buying paint in tubes, and it just became so much demand for manufactured paint by mid 19th century, and artists wanted to there was a certain demand for certain different pigments. If you look at Hudson River painters, like a late Hudson River painter Frederick Church, in Twilight in the Wilderness, those really bright reds and are vermilion. But some of the bright yellows could be chrome yellow or cadmium yellow, which were 19th century developments. There's purple in the painting. There's a possible cerulean blue. Those were all mid 19th century. And so artists would were looking for brighter pigments, and so there was a demand, and then it just became a big industry, I think.
Yeah, so someone who was a, you used the word color man, right? Mm-hmm. Someone who was a color man would try to satisfy that demand. Right?
Yeah, and you could go into a colorman shop in Philadelphia, and you could buy canvas, stretchers, pigments, tube paints, anything you wanted, varnishes, all types of oils by the early 19th century.
Right. And we're not going to talk about the 20th century synthetic organic chemistry of pigments like copper thalocyanines and quinacridones and things
well,
like that.
Well, those some of those are great improvements on the mauve and coal tar things right. that came out. Right. By the time you get to Hansa yellow or something like that in the 30s, that's a fairly stable pigment, and they are an improvement. And phthalo greens, they are, and blues mm-hmm. are an improvement over some of the earlier things. So in a way, those are improvements on what people wanted in the 19th century, which was bright coal tar reds and lavenders and things like that, that they knew pretty quickly weren't going to last, and they faded. Mm-hmm. And then the later industry sort of corrects that with better quality dye-based pigments.
Right. And in the hands of an artist, a dramatic, color-fast, stable, bright color
yeah.
is a wonderful tool, right?
Yes.
Because
yeah.
you can always make things duller.
Yeah, right. Yeah, exactly.
So, Mark, you are a conservator. You have worked on paintings from different time periods. What kind of things do you need to be aware of in different paintings from these different time periods as a conservator?
For me, the one thing which I think is so important that they drill into in conservation school, and which you supplement by lots and lots of reading over the years and by looking at paintings, is the different techniques that are used. You really have to understand how the painting was built and how it was layered and constructed from the bottom up. You have to understand the media that were used. You have to understand when you have to examine a painting for a long time under a microscope to figure out whether this is discolored varnish or this is yellow paint, which might be similar color. You really have to read all the treatises you can and understand how the technique and which could vary period by period from an artist. There are certain paintings where an artist didn't experiment for the first part of his or her career, and then later ones had disastrous experimentation results with lots of cracking or fading or problems like that.
So what is one horrible pigment, do you think, that has caused problems?
Well, I think the bitumen, which related to mummy, which we were talking about earlier, that's a pigment which Joshua Reynolds used in a later portrait of Master Bunbury. You can see he has nice pink cheeks, rosy cheeks, because Reynolds stopped using the cochineal with this ground up red insect dye. For Carmen Lakes, he stopped using that, but in his career, he substituted bitumen. And bitumen is a tarry substance that just won't dry, so anything you put on top of that is going to shrink and crack, and it becomes this kind of alligator skin-like effect, or beaded up. So he substitutes one vice for another. And the problem with, and then the bitumen was used a lot by the English School of Painting, late 18th century, throughout the 19th, and a lot of other artists, too. And you just get these, in even Frank Duveneck, the Turkish page from the Pennsylvania Academy, that painting, he was trained in Munich, and I think there was a fair amount of bitumen use, or at least not proper drying of layers. Mm-hmm. And you can see wide cracks on some of those paintings. And those are tricky to work with. You have to use different techniques to work on some of those paintings where the paint isn't quite hard yet.
And if you're trying to restore a painting like that, would you use different materials, or would you try
well,
to go back?
Well, you would in this different techniques, in the sense that you painting with bitumen in it, probably you can't use the same solvents to clean it that you might a painting that doesn't have open cracks like that. You certainly can't use any heat with something with bitumen in it. A lot of conservation techniques involve use of a small tacking iron or a heating an area locally, and you can't do that because it'll flow. It's
right.
Tar. You heat it up a little bit and it'll just flow.
Yeah.
So
that sounds as though it might be the end of the painting if that
and
happens.
Sometimes in the past people have done that.
Oof.
Yeah.
Oof. So that would be a horror story.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
I have a another question on Twitter. I'm not sure exactly who to address it to, but it's from Grand Arcanian. And it's, how does the type of oil used affect the paint? What other oils can be used?
Sure. Well, linseed oil is probably the most common, particularly for northern painters. Walnut oil can be used. It's often used in Italy. Poppy seed oil, as you mentioned earlier, is another possibility. And certainly looking back to older painting traditions like tempera with, you know, with egg whites and things like that. So there's a whole host of things. And you can treat the oils in various ways. You can heat thicken it. You can, some painters left their oil in the sun to heat and thicken and stuff like that. Stand oil, plate oil. These are all variations on doing treatments to oils to produce a thickened or a thinned effect.
If you're looking for permanence in the painting technique in the choice of oil, there's sort of a unfortunate paradox where people knew early on that linseed oil, although it made a nice hard layer that was you could clean over it and it dried thoroughly without wrinkling unless you applied it too thickly. People knew from early on that it did yellow quite a bit. So the poppy seed oil and later safflower oil and walnut oil, those are sometimes substituted, especially added to white paint so that it wouldn't yellow noticeably. But they don't form as hard of a film. So you have it won't yellow as much, but it will be more sensitive to solvents and it might even crack more. Or if it's applied too thickly, it might curdle with some other oils that are available. So.
If this were a different program, we'd talk about the oxidative cross-linking of conjugated double bonds,
and,
but we're not going to talk about that here, are
why
we?
Not?
I don't think we are. I think since we only have another 10 minutes or so left, we're definitely going to talk, not going to talk about that. But that was a nice try.
Thank you, Macau.
But getting back to conservation, which may end up in chemistry as well, how do we, you as a conservator, how do conservators make sure that our art history doesn't crumble? How do you, I mean, everything gets old. Mm-hmm. Is there a point where you just say there's nothing to be done, or is there always something you can do to help a painting?
There's virtually always something that you can do, and at the very least, even if you find a painting that you can't clean because the artist has just put thick varnish on a painting that's full of varnish or something and you can't clean it, the paintings also flake and the paint flakes start to separate from the fabric. You can almost always try to find a way to consolidate that and preserve it. So in the same way, you know, conservators who work with textiles or something, even they can preserve a fragment of something. They may not be able to display it upright, but there's still a way of housing it in such a way that it can be a study piece at the very least. Most things you can do something for to at least stabilize them, even if you can't restore them in the sense of making them look closer to the original appearance. But most things can be at least stabilized for future generations.
Well, also, I know that you actually did conservation work on one of CHF's paintings. I think
the Eustace von Bentham. Mm-hmm.
What did you do in that case?
That was actually a really large treatment. It was a large painting, but also it was a painting that had a lot of discolored varnish. It had some issues with the fabric being puckered. But the biggest problem with it is it had a lot of restorer's repaint. It had been scrubbed thin in some shadow areas and a lot of details were missing. Unfortunately, we don't have a picture of it before treatment, but it was quite yellow, and also some of the reflections on the glass had been restored in such a way that they didn't make sense. There was extra embers and cinders flying through the air that were repaint. There were just sections of it that had been falsified. I think one of the windows was repainted incorrectly. And it took forever looking at it under a microscope and going through layers to figure out what was repaint and what was original. And that was the biggest problem with the treatment, is just trying to find out what was original and what should be removed. And once I figured out what was repaint and got that off, the painting was very abraded, but I was able to then reconstruct it by careful in-painting, and when it was finished, you could see that without extraneous highlights on the glass, that there was this consistency to the way he painted it. It really did have this instantaneous effect of an explosion in light, and every highlight was just perfectly placed. It's really amazing that he painted that at that time, you know, clearly no photography, and I don't know that he'd ever actually seen an explosion. I hope not. but it was just very consistent lighting, and there was actually a lot more color in it when it was finished, too. So it was actually very satisfying. It was a long treatment, but it was a satisfying job.
So it sounds as though you can also use conservation techniques to identify a painter, like to prove or disprove that someone painted a particular painting.
I think you can use it to find the period, approximate period when a painter was painted. I would disagree, though, that you can use it as a diagnostic technique for an individual painter, because so many painters use similar materials within a given period. So it's not like Rembrandt and Jan Leven's contemporaries might have completely opposite palettes, or that that this famous artist was the only one of that period using this particular pigment. I mean, you don't see that. Becomes more a matter of testing for pigments to see whether this is repaint, because it's Prussian blue after 1704 on an Italian Renaissance Madonna's robe. You know, that sort of thing. Since we know a lot about the history of pigments, we can date that way, but it's not so much on an individual artist basis.
Right. So the movie Monuments Men came out earlier this year, and that represents a popular culture presentation of conservation.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to hear your comments on that. So, Lisa, how does popular culture represent conservation?
Well, I think it doesn't represent it quite enough. I think that Painting Science is incredibly fascinating and very rich. And I haven't seen Monuments Men, but I have the only sort of pop culture representation of pigment science that I can think of is Girl with a Pearl Earring, which had a scene where Scarlett Johansson and Colin Firth, AKA Vermeer, are grinding pigments together in a very very sensual pottery scene in Ghost type atmosphere, and it's very funny because he sort of picks up a rock and is like, grind this. but it was, you know, even for all the inaccuracies, it's kind of nice to see the raw materials getting across.
I haven't seen Monuments Men yet, but it does, the main, I think the George Clooney role is an actual conservator, George Stout, who was director at the Worcester Art Museum for many years, and is one of the biggest figures in the early development of our conservation field in the 30s mm-hmm. and 40s. The sort of stuff that is really misrepresented in movies is Sigourney Weaver in Ghostbusters, who from one movie to the other, she's gone from one job to just taking on a job at the what appears to be the Metropolitan Museum of Art as a conservator. And conservators all cringe when she turns away from the painting while she's cleaning it. You know, it takes a little, I would just like to say, it takes a little more concentration than is often depicted in the movies.
Well, I think we have just about run out of time. I think we have time for one more Twitter question, which is, here's a simple one from Chat Fiddle. Which pigments are the most resilient? If you wanted a painting to last 1,000 years, what would you choose?
Well, I would choose the pigments that the Egyptians used then. If I wanted a painting to last 1,000 years, I'd choose something that has lasted 10,000.
Yeah.
because there, you know, you can, there's basically, you know, orpiment lasts a really long time. Carbon, all the carbon pigments will last basically forever. And the, you know, mineral pigments and things like that have great staying power because they're ground up minerals. You know what I mean? Like what can you do to that short of sort of atomically blasting them?
The ones that earth pigments last a long time. The ones that have long chemical organic names that are dye based, those aren't as long lasting mm-hmm. generally. Mm-hmm. And it is an American paint manufacturers are at least required to have permanency ratings on their tube paints, and those are pretty accurate mm-hmm. ASTM standards. So I think you could trust those.
So we've come to the end. I'd like to thank our guests, Lisa Berry Drago, Mark Bockrath. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you.
And thanks to you for joining us on this particular episode of Distillations. Good night.
Yay.